Exploring these maps since my Alexandria video. I've been looking at these and I'd like to go a little further back in time. Of today's instructional video is to simply put your butts to sleep while I peruse la paleta. Actually, it's just caves. Different prehistoric sites in France, well, all around the world, but I was trying to focus on areas in France and Spain, I guess. Okay, so I apologize for the slow internet connection. Okay, so there is Portugal, Chycho. Satellite view. No, I guess not. I guess. Oh, there we go. Wow. Well, before, while that's loading, I was looking at this cave in Spain. And then before that, I was looking at this cave in France. Construction of which there were apparently stalagmites, yeah, that were broken and were found from around 300 meters in front of the cave entrance, and they dated some of the sites. Thoroughly amazed, impressed by that. So, let's go to this one. Les Aziz de Tayac. Now this one I especially want to learn more about. It's actually very coincidental, I just clicked on it. I didn't see that name. But it's the cave that was mentioned in the film The Man from Earth, which I highly, highly recommend you go see. Or you purchase, because it's just a very, very captivating historical fiction book, science fiction. It's just, it was a beautiful story, and I don't want to give too much away, but watch my favorite movies episode that I just recently put out if you'd like to learn a little bit more about it. But essentially, it's a man who had lived 14,000 years, and he explored the Eurasian continent from France all the way to India, and beautiful story, but I'm in particular fascinated by the fact that we don't know history beyond the written, definitely beyond the written histories of maybe Egypt, India, China, Babylon, Mesopotamia, and some sparse areas in Europe that only go back maybe 6,000 years. So, Les Aziz. So that's what's instigating me to want to explore this map that has all these very ancient, very, very prehistoric, Neolithic sites that were marked by archaeologists. They were able to mark them, find paintings, rock sculptures, and all sorts of other things from 28,000 years ago. So, anatomically modern human remains found here, dated to at most 28,000 years ago, correspond with that. I don't know what that is. Sorry. So, I was hoping to be a little bit more professional about this. Looks like they're gonna make me search for the cave. That sucks. I don't know what to do. I thought real bummer. They're not showing me the satellite view. Well, I'll do what I was doing before, I guess. Show you guys some pictures of this beautiful cave. So we have it on Wikipedia. Les Aziz. In March 1868, the geologist Louis Larte, financed by some guy, discovered the first five skeletons of Cro-Magnons, the earliest known examples of our species, Homo sapiens, in the Cro-Magnon rock shelter, at Les Aziz de Tayac. These skeletons included a fetus, and the skulls were remarkably modern looking and much rounder than the earlier Neanderthal. And our formatting is ridiculously off here, but World Heritage Site. Lascaux Cave. Anyone watching from France, which hopefully there are a lot of you, because if I'm smart, I'll put France in the title. Hopefully you guys can help me pronounce some of these words. Post hoc. It's the setting of a complex of caves near the village of Montagnac. Over 600 parietal wall paintings cover the interior walls and ceilings of the cave. The paintings represent primarily large animals, typical local and contemporary fauna, that correspond with the fossil record of the Upper Paleolithic time. The drawings are a combined effort of many generations and continued debate. The paintings are estimated around 17,000. So, 1940, the entrance of the cave to Lascaux Cave was discovered by 18-year-old Marcel Ravidant. He returned and they entered the cave via a long shaft. Teenagers discovered that cave walls were covered with depictions of animals, galleries that suggest continuity, context, or simply represent a cavern, were given names. Okay, that's all boring. I don't care about how many visitors it had. Another unless we're talking about 17,000 years ago or 19,000 years ago. Alright, that's somewhat interesting, but I want to know the history. In 1955, carbon dioxide, heat, and humidity, and other contaminants produced by 1,200 visitors per day had visibly damaged the paintings. As air condition deteriorated, fungi and lichen increasingly infested the walls. Consequently, the cave was closed to the public in 1963. The paintings were restored to their original state. Okay, let's find out the history of it. The most famous. Over 900 can be identified as animals, and 605 of these have been precisely identified. Out of these images, there are 364. There are paintings of equines, as well as 90 paintings of stags. Also represented are cattle and bison, each representing 4 to 5% of the images. And then a smattering of other images include 7 felines, a bird, a bear, a rhinoceros, and even a human. There are no images of reindeer, even though that was the principal source of food for the artists. And then geometric images also have been found on the walls. So, the Hall of Bulls. Let's look at these pictures. Giant deer from Alaska. Reproduction. What does that mean? It's weird. Freaking horse. It blows my mind that 19,000 years ago, we were painting shit. Possibly with shit. Alright guys, I wanna keep it moving, cause that's fascinating, but there's also apparently lots of other places. Yeah, so look. This one goes all the way back. Our Wikipedia is too boring. We need something. Aurignacian from 42,000 years ago through lower Sultrian levels until max 17,000 years ago, with anatomically modern human remains, tools, and artifacts. Wow. It's really irritating that stupid site doesn't allow you satellite views. I guess it's just not up to date. It's so stupid. Very dumb. See, I want to show you guys these pictures, but I want to have a little bit of information, ideally, with it as well. This is not working out as smooth as I thought. It's always directing me to Wikipedia, which I will go to Wikipedia. So the site includes human remains, stone tools, and early cultural artifacts made during the Upper Paleolithic. Maybe 47,000 to 17,000 years ago. In 1958, a small carved female figure was found on a stone about 8 inches tall, likely dating to 21,000 years ago BC. But I guess it really 2,000 years is beginning to be more and more inconsequential. So, forgive me if I keep misinterpreting the BB. I guess that's the atheistic designation. The figure represents a comparatively young woman, more slender, gracile than is normally the case, roughly carved with contours suggesting pregnancy. Movius wrote that despite disharmonic features, the overall proportions of the figure are both pleasing and, at first glance, symmetrical. Movius continued, from a stylistic point of view, the figure has been rendered in the finest tradition of Upper Paleolithic art, as represented by the well-known series of carvings and statuettes collectively known as Venuses. The figure was found following a violent storm, making its origin within the shelter difficult to know exactly. what, let me switch it up. Let's go up to this place. Chancellare. Magdalenian, anatomically modern human remains. A male burial, dated to 17,000 years ago. Found in the cave of Raymondan Chancellet. See if these photos pop up. Probably won't, because my internet is terrible right now. Sorry, guys. But, oh, there they go. Ooh, look at that. It's very beautiful. Okay. That's awesome, but Magdalenian culture. And I really want to know. Yeah, there we go. I know I'm just browsing Google Maps, but you'd think there would be a lot more soul and a lot more a sense of wonder and awe about these types of things. I mean, these are fucking 15,000 to 50,000 years old. I mean, the last 1,000 years, most people can't even comprehend. It's like, I feel like there needs to be more passion. See if this website helps us out. It's just amazing that we're just in the last couple thousand years we've emerged and developed technology to keep us from relatively safe. And technology was kind of the very, very latest invention. I think the origin of the organization of culture and cities and society, and the fact that we've been able to exist and work in concert to harvest edible plants, agriculture, and farm animals, and provide sustainably, consistently for hundreds of years at a stretch for entire cities, thousands and thousands, sometimes millions of people. And that's a miracle, just how we were able to do that. And these people were over here, you know, living in the wilderness, and you know, every night the sun would set and there would be beasts of prey, nocturnal beasts that would easily snatch babies and eat them. I mean, down here there'd be gators, up there there'd be some sort of cats, I'm sure, some saber-toothed tigers maybe. Here the map of Europe shows the continents, contours of the European continent in the area belonging to the Magdalenian caribou and horse hunters. That's cool. Yeah. So yeah, just, let's see if we can get map. Let's get a better view. More high res. one looks really, really boring. So I tried to avoid it. Yeah, it's too boring. And just look at... Hold on a minute. What am I doing? Ice Age map of Europe. Alright, so that's what I really wanted to look at. So, 17,000 years ago, an evolutionary shift occurred. The productions of tools and weapons with respect to previous cultures, such as the Sultrian and Metagulian. A hunter's equipment basically consisted of sagey points and flint spears. Tips. The production techniques changed throughout 6,000 years of the Magdalenian, however, there were shifts in production. The harpoon appeared about 12,000 years before present. The last glacial period of the Pleistocene reached its maximum extent some 20,000 years ago, a time when vast areas of the Earth were covered in a thick layer of ice. The Middle Magdalenian period, 13 to 15,000 before present, marked the beginning of the tardiglacial period, a time of climactic instability, which gave rise to the relative stability of the late glacial maximum. Sea levels were some 120 meters, 120 meters, or 360 feet lower than the current shorelines. That's an awesome fact. Just imagine going to your nearest beach and it being 360 feet lower, or 120 meters lower than it currently is. I think Florida would be about four times as wide as it currently is. God, that's so, so cool. Now, the variations connected with the Heinrich event 1H1 were swift and large scale. One of the key consequences that the huge quantities of fresh cold water from melting icebergs were released quickly, which cooled surface waters and triggered desertification. Didn't know how to accentuate that one. The prevailing climate during the Middle Magdalenian was thus very cold and very dry. Okay. Of course, it's on Reddit. Awesome. Let's look at... Now, what is that? It's supposed to be England? Right there. trying to drag it. God. Yeah, so I guess that is England, but it doesn't really show exactly the, something like this. So, England and Ireland would have been under ice. Wow. And Italy and Sicily would have been connected. Yeah, everything would have been fatter, really. A lot more terrain. Guys, well, this was a very chaotic episode, a little adventure around three caves in France 36,000 years ago. Damn. If I ever went to France, I think I'd like to go visit some of these caves. It's so amazing that 30, 50, you know, probably 100,000 years ago, just for even 50,000 years, we were still. See, I've actually, let me finish my thought. It was that, regardless of what these more, audacious speculations of Graham Hancock are, whether they're true or not, I mean, he's positing that there were extremely advanced civilizations beyond 12,000 years ago. That possibly got wiped out during a cataclysmic flood that possibly was caused by a comet impacting the, northern hemisphere somewhere that caused all the maximized ice to flood everywhere. But, you know, even if that's true, which that would be, God, that would be bewilderingly fascinating if it was. I think it's important enough for us to be in awe and wonder of our own actual well-known history, in the sense that we know because of our existence that we as a species, as a human species across the entire world, we survived millions of years of evolution. Well, billions really. As humans, as intelligent monkeys with opposable thumbs who harnessed fire, we've at least been around for a couple million years, and I think that speaks volumes about our abilities to survive in the wild. And I think it says something about our innate abilities. You know, like, for me, You know, A, I think about the fact that I'm going to be dead one day, and B, I think about how badass all of my thousands and thousands of ancestors in my bloodline must have been to survive in the wild throughout extreme climates with ridiculously horrifying predators, and just the high functioning cognitive abilities, and not to mention the incredible physical abilities they must have had and been capable of. Here, pre-Neolithic DNA. But yeah, I think about that when I get anxious about my little dainty first world problems. Say, fuck you, Rich. You got badass ancestors. Don't let them down. And plus, you're gonna die in like 40 years. I think it's very useful to be inspired by our history and what we know. Equally to be inspired by science and our ability to harness scientific truths that we know, mathematical concepts that translate into physical reality that we harness to create electronics using quantum mechanics and rockets to send us to outer space and travel the solar system, land on the moon, and God, I think our species are just, we're burgeoning with possibility. If we all just reminded ourselves how awesome we really are, or at least have the potential to be, we would live in such an extraordinary world of people pushing themselves to the absolute limit. But here's the kicker. We are capable of developing empathy and treating all of our neighbors as empathetically as we would treat our own family members, the ones we care about at least. So just remember that, how good life could be if we all got our shit together and pushed ourselves to our uppermost. I need to work on my speaking skills, speaking of that. But our limits, if we pushed ourselves to our uppermost limits every day, it'd become habit. And just imagine having a planet full of high functioning empathetic. That's the main part. So you have to have, you can't have one without the other, or else it just becomes a game of dominance like it's been for the last million years. We need to look to our side, and if we're in a position of power, we need to look down and see who around us we can help. And if everybody else is looking around them, seeing what little things they can do to help their neighbors, God, this world would be so, so beautiful to live in. So much more beautiful. Our lives would be overflowing with meaning. We would never even need to ask about heaven, because we would be so content at the day of our deaths with the full, exciting, adventurous life that we lived, and the people we helped, and the memories we shared with them. So that's my hope, and I hope it's yours too.